O bless the Lord, my soul. His mercy is bad in mind. Forget not all his benefits. The Lord to thee is kind.
Then bless his holy name, whose grace hath made me whole, whose loving kindness crowns thy days. O bless the Lord, my soul.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
O Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
Come, let us adore him. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy.
Come, let us adore him.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures, and leads me beside still waters.
He revives my soul, and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
First lesson is from the book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called. Well, he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by and said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, and he had beautiful eyes, and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then sent out and went to Ramah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please read with me Canticle 12. Glorify the Lord, all you works of the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Let the people of God glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, O priests and servants of the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, O saints and souls of the righteous. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. You that are holy and humble of heart, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Let us glorify the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
The second lesson is from the book of Romans. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to read with me Canticle 19. O ruler of the universe, Lord God, great deeds are they that you have done, surpassing human understanding. Your ways are ways of righteousness and truth, O King of all the ages. Who can fail to do you homage, Lord, and sing the praises of your name? For you only are the Holy One. All nations will draw near and fall down before you, because your just and holy works have been revealed. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from John. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, but it is someone like him. He kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner perform such signs? And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened. He said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked him, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age, ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, give glory to God. We know this man is a sinner. He answered, I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? Then they reviled him, saying, you are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to the one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born entirely in sins, and you are trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking to you is he. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, surely we are not blind, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say, we see, your sin remains. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the reading from Samuel today, we have a piece of the story of David being chosen as king. And like all the kings of Israel before and after him, David is chosen by God. And Samuel the prophet takes a long ram's horn, probably with a big long curve in it, and it's all filled with oil. And he pours all the oil over David's head and anoints him. This oil is precious, and it would have been made really carefully, following instructions that God gives to Israel in Exodus, using herbs and plants to make it smell sweet. It is a sensory, tangible reminder of God's favor and of God's goodness. And the anointing of David sets him aside as a leader, as a governor of the people, someone who would protect them and lead them and keep them safe. This oil was originally reserved only for the priests of Israel. But by the time we come to David, it has become the custom to anoint kings in this way also, to set them aside for what is intended to be a holy life, to call them into their responsibility to love and protect and serve the people, to enact just laws and to work with God and with God's prophets to make sure that that covenant God made with Israel stays intact. When we meet David this morning, he is young. His whole story as we know it hasn't happened yet. He hasn't yet met or defeated Goliath. He doesn't yet know the struggle of war. He hasn't met the people who will define his life. He isn't married. He hasn't had children. He doesn't know that he will make mistakes, big ones, and he hasn't suffered. He also hasn't known the anxiety of loving someone and wanting to keep them safe, but he also hasn't known the joy or the nuance of any of those things. He is only a young boy, and all he knows is how to be a shepherd. Now, we don't know exactly when David wrote these words to the 23rd Psalm, but I am willing to bet that they came significantly later in his life, later in the story, because these are the words of someone who has some wisdom of experience, someone a little more nuanced, a little more aware of the world, someone who has made mistakes and repented of them, someone who has learned to rely not on his own strength, but on God's strength. These are the words of someone who is overwhelmed by the fact that God is still good to us and loves us, even when we've made mistakes, even when we've betrayed God's trust. And David writes about all of this in the 23rd Psalm in the context that he knew best as a young man, and he compares our relationship with God to that between shepherd and sheep. Now, if you've spent any time in and around the church, you've probably heard me or some other clergy person talk about the fact that sheep aren't very bright. And that's true. They're not terribly bright. But they're also not quite as stupid as sometimes we make them out to be. What they are is fairly helpless. Domesticated sheep need their shepherd to do just about everything for them. They are completely defenseless against predators. They certainly aren't fast, right? Have you ever seen a sheep run particularly quickly? They aren't agile. And when they're afraid, they sort of panic and they freeze, and they can literally be scared to death. They're also afraid of just about everything else around them, everything they can't understand, including things like running water. And before you judge them for that, I want you to just think about their shape for a minute. They are not exactly God's most aerodynamic creature, and all that wool must get very heavy. So fast running water creates anxiety for them and fear for them, and they need to be led by their shepherd to still water in order to feel safe enough to drink and to let themselves be refreshed. Also, if you leave sheep unattended in a pasture, they will just eat and eat and eat and eat until all the food is gone. They will use it all up without thinking about tomorrow, without thinking about next week, and they will literally eat until they are beyond sick, which means that the shepherd also has to lead them around to find the places where the grass is green, to let some fields grow, to find the next place of safety and also sort of rein in their sheep instincts to save them from themselves. So it's true that sheep aren't exactly bright, but they do have other gifts, and like all of God's creatures, they are redeemable. There are a few good things about them, and there's one thing that they are really, really good at, and that is relationship. They learn to depend completely on the shepherd. They learn to follow that one voice that they know will provide for them. They are docile enough to be led, and they form a relationship over time with their shepherd that is all about trust. And that changes the way that we hear those words. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul and leads me in pathways of righteousness. This first part of the psalm is all about health and life and about God's care for us. It's about God's desire to give us what we need. It doesn't mean, of course, that we'll never want anything or that we'll always get what we want. Like David, we know that that's not really true. Life doesn't really work that way. But what David's trying to acknowledge is his belief that God is going to give us what we really need, and that God wants to lead us to good things. These are the words of someone who is trying to live their life while they draw on the strength of God instead of just their own. Somebody who is glad to have the protection of God, who is a shepherd. In David's words, we can hear that he wants to be guided. He has some understanding of the fact that he needs someone to lead him to refreshment and peace, that he can't find it on his own. And then he shifts gears a little bit. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Meaning, even when I feel like death is near to me, I am not afraid, because you, Lord, are with me and you are there to protect me. And he refers to the rod and staff, the tools of a shepherd, the rod being something that the shepherd would use to fight off danger and to send away predators, and the staff, that long staff with the curved neck that is still what our bishops carry when they walk into worship with us, that staff is about reining in the sheep, right? It's literally about sort of putting it around their necks and pulling them somewhere. It's quick action to keep them away from something or to change their direction. It's about God's authority and the power of God's law sort of hemming us in on every side and keeping us safe. Even facing death, David is unafraid because he knows that God is with him. And he knows he doesn't have to depend just on himself. You spread a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup runs over. Gosh, that is such good news, that we have a God who calls us to the table and invites us to be reconciled, to be in good, healthy relationships, to work out our differences, and to know that as we do that, God will keep us safe and provide for everyone. And then, of course, David references this oil that we started with today. The time of that oil being used for kings and for priests alone is long past. Instead, that same oil traces a cross on all of our heads at baptism, and it is a visible, tangible sign of God's love for you, no longer reserved for just a few people, but now, because of Jesus, that anointing oil is for everyone. And it symbolizes for us a spiritual anointing that Jesus promises by the power and the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that declares that you are precious, and that you too have been set aside as God's beloved for a particular purpose, which gives our lives a different kind of meaning. And it invites us to live in a way that is free from fear and marked by joy. And that's the reference to "my cup runs over." This is the promise of abundance, that God wants to give us more than we can even hold, more than we even know what to do with. And of course, this isn't really about wine or food. Even though we love those metaphors, those images in scripture of community and new life, what this really is about is joy and abundance, connection and certainty, the ability to trust in the relationship that we have with God and in the relationship that we have with the rest of the flock, which we'll come back to in just a minute. God wants us in the midst of this life and all that troubles us to know joy, joy that fills our cup, joy that runs over, joy that never runs out. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Unlike the young David that we meet this morning, who's just barely anointed, the David who wrote these words is someone who knows God's forgiveness, someone who's made mistakes and repented of them, someone who's found his way back to God. These are the words of someone who knows that even though he is imperfect, God's mercy and forgiveness is eternal and present and constant and insistent. And that is why he is confident enough to say, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." We should see in these words David's faith, David's conviction that God will act, and that no matter what, this is how the story ends: in the house of the Lord forever. For generations, this psalm has been a present help in trouble, a comfort in the storm. We hear it particularly at funerals and when we are in the midst of grief, because somewhere in the midst of these ancient words, David captures the relationship between shepherd and sheep and shows us both the strength and the comfort that comes from that relationship. He reminds us that there is hope and goodness in being sheep because we have a good shepherd. Jesus himself tells us that the good shepherd leaves the 99 and goes after the one lost sheep, and that the shepherd won't rest until all of those sheep, each one of them, is safe in the fold, until the whole flock is complete. And that brings us back to the one thing that we really need to know about sheep this morning, something David and Jesus would have taken for granted when they talked about God's people as sheep, something they would assume that we would know, but you know, most of us aren't perhaps as familiar with sheep as they are. So here's the thing. Sheep may not be all that bright, but they are intensely social creatures. Even as they rely on the shepherd, they form deep bonds with each other. They need each other. They love each other. They form strong friendships. They stick up for each other. They're loyal to each other. And they're actually very complex social beings who need to be in relationship. And the health of the whole flock depends on these many relationships. And they learn to move forward together. They learn to make their way through life. They learn to respond to the voice of the shepherd together. They rest together. They eat together. They find safety and reassurance in each other. Which is why this morning, more than any other text we heard, I want you to have this psalm, to hear it again, to make it your own, to incorporate it into your prayers for the rest of this season of Lent. Read it in the morning when you get up, or at night before you go to sleep. Listen to the many different hymns and settings that we sing. But keep these words with you, because the good news that you are longing to hear is right here in this psalm, in the two things that every good sheep knows. You can trust the shepherd, and you need to be with the flock. We are living in strange and disorienting times, and we are surrounded by the rushing, fast water of anxiety, and it threatens us. And we're surrounded too by the food and the wine of this world, the resources and voices that will not fill us and will not comfort us, no matter how much of it we take in, no matter how much it promises to make it better. And the stories we hear around us right now would lead us to believe that we are nearing the entrance to the valley of the shadow of death. And I know that for many of us, it feels like there is danger just beyond the gate. And we are only sheep. But we can trust the shepherd, and we can move with the flock. We can learn to dwell in and breathe in and abide in and hold on to our relationship with the shepherd, who will always come for us, particularly when we're lost, pick us up, put us on his shoulders, and take us back to the safety of the fold. Because to this shepherd, every sheep is precious. And because the shepherd knows that we belong together. And we trust more, we hope more, we love more, we live more when we do it together as one flock. So take this psalm today as a guidepost, as a sign, as a comfort, and make these words your own. Hear David's witness that faith isn't just believing that God exists, it's learning to trust in God. Lean deeply into that relationship with your good shepherd and rely on this community, on this flock. And be part of how this flock is learning to move differently, because we are. We are learning how to move and how to keep each other safe, how to maintain relationships, and how to be together in the midst of this very strange time. And I believe that even though we aren't together in person this morning, even though it might be a long time until we're together again, I believe that God comes to us in our various places and gathers us up in worship and in prayer and unites us again, making us that one flock and reminding us of that one shepherd. No matter who you are or where you are, if you are praying with us, you are part of this flock, and God loves you and longs to lead you to still water and green pastures. Trust this good shepherd and come be part of this flock. Log in, zoom in, plug in to our worship and our learning and our fellowship, and together we will continue to grow in our trust of God's promise to wipe away every tear, to still every racing heart, to calm, to love, to welcome, and to save all people. Together, God will lead us away from the rushing water of fear and anxiety toward green pastures and still waters and in through the gate that leads to eternal life, so that each of us might dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon the earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
God, the author of peace and lover of concord, to know you is eternal life and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We pray for all who are sick and in need of our prayers, especially Donnie, James, Jeff, Aaron, Michael, Steve, Kim, Katie, Brooke, Laura, Petra, Doris, Lane, Richard, Mary Lou, Ellen, Kirk, and Charles, and for all those we now name. Gracious and loving God, our only help in time of need, we humbly ask you to behold your people, to relieve and comfort those around the world who are suffering from coronavirus. Look upon them with the eyes of comfort them with a sense of your goodness, preserve them from the temptations of the enemy, and give them peace in their affliction. In your good time, restore them to health and enable them to lead the rest of their lives in your favor and to your glory. And grant that they may dwell with you in life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you to offer your own prayers of intercession and thanksgiving, either silently or aloud.
Dear God, thank you for giving the blessings of community, education, staying connected, and our health. We pray that we have the ability to help others in need in the time that is hard, and that those who are lonely have the comfort and presence of you. We trust you to lead us to use our blessings to bless others and pray for others in need. Amen.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you for the honor of your name. Amen.
Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with true thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up of ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all of our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
So, a brief moment of announcements. I was already going to say that we are learning how to move differently through this time, and that is definitely true, and we will continue to adapt. So stay with us while we work through the challenges. The good news is that in the past week, all of our programming that was regularly scheduled has happened online. We have programs for members and friends of all ages, all kinds of worship and fellowship and formation that's just sort of set for you. So if you haven't joined us yet for some of this, please do. You'll continue to get regular emails from us about what's available and about how to connect. And if you need anything or if you're having trouble connecting, please do be in touch. This afternoon at 2:00, you're invited into a Zoom room for a virtual version of Pub Theology. So I hope you'll join us for that. Questions and information went out in your email yesterday and can be found on the website. And tomorrow, please join us for a virtual coffee hour from 10 to 11:30. I think we have a quick announcement from Sam.
Hi, good morning. The prayer that I just read a moment ago was crafted by our 6th, 7th, and 8th graders who met on Zoom last week. And next Sunday, you will be hearing a prayer that was created by our high schoolers. So be on the lookout. The youth programming is looking to be a bigger part of our worship than we maybe have been able to in the past, and we're grateful for that. This afternoon at 4, our joint youth ministry high school group will be meeting, and this Tuesday we will have our joint 8th grade meeting. I will continue to send out emails on virtual Zoom meetings. Wednesdays and Thursdays at 4, I'll be holding meetings for just the St. Matt's middle school and high school, and we hope that we can continue to bless our community with our younger voices. Thanks.
As is always true, by God's grace, our life together is the merging of many gifts that God has given us. And we are at our best when those gifts come together to sustain the whole community. And that is what has happened over the last 10 days. And I am really grateful for all of the people that continue to lend us their gifts and bring us together online. Please, would you join us in singing a closing hymn?
Open now the crystal fountain, whence the healing stream doth flow. Let the fallen cloudy pillar lead me on my journey through. Strong deliverer, strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Be thou still my strength and shield.
When I tread the verge of Jordan, bid my anxious fear subside. Death of death and hell's destruction, lend me safe on Canaan's side. Songs of praises, songs of praises, I will ever give to thee. I will ever give to thee.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.